Hello and welcome to Jo Gard's Writing Life. I'm Jo, I'm a writer and script consultant based in the UK, and this is my YouTube channel where I talk about writing. This week I wanted to talk a little bit about structure, and I decided I would do a video on the 8-sequence structure because I think that it's one of those it's one of the structures that not a lot of people know about. You know, most people are familiar with the 3-act structure, some people are familiar with the 5-act structure, but I feel like not a lot of people know about the 8-sequence structure, and it can be really helpful. Like, it's really helpful for me when I was writing a thriller script, but I think it can also be applied to novels as well. So if structure is something that you struggle with, then perhaps this video might be of some help to you. So let's begin. I've got some little cards here that I might be referring to. Okay, so sequence one is the same as act one, really. It's about establishing the undisturbed status quo in your story world. So it's, you know, the beginning when everything is seemingly normal before an event turns everything on its head. At the end of sequence one, you want that hook, you know, that turn, that thing that's surprising about your story that's going to draw the reader in or that's going to draw the viewer in. You want that to happen at the end of sequence one, to keep people reading, but also to keep to pique the interest in your story. So in sequence two, you want to build on that hook, you want to build on those dilemmas that hook presents and the obstacles that are to come. This is the part where you establish the main tension of the film, like what are the stakes, what are the stakes for your main character and how are they going to play out. This is where you're sort of establishing that and you're perhaps dropping clues or hinting at the troubles to come or the struggles to come for that particular character. And then sequence three is an elaboration of these future obstacles, and it's also an opportunity for you to introduce new characters. So perhaps there'll be a buddy that comes along, you know, that's sort of like a helpful character, a friend, a sidekick, or whatever. Or perhaps you're going to introduce an antagonist or a baddie, you know, that kind of character. Or maybe you're just going to focus a little bit more on a few characters that later on you're going to use in the subplot. So sequence three is the opportunity for you to introduce new characters and elaborate on the future obstacles that your main character and perhaps those other characters are going to face. Sequence four is where the first obstacle is presented and overcome. So basically, it's the part of the story where your character gets to achieve something. Perhaps if it's a thriller, they get to show their skills. Perhaps the first obstacle is a chase, and your main character manages to outwit his or her pursuers, so therefore by getting away, a goal is achieved, an obstacle is overcome, and this is the kind of point where your character is perhaps gaining a little bit of ground. At the end of sequence four, this is the midpoint of your film or the midpoint of your book, and it's the point where your character is closest to what he or she wants. I say wants because that's different to needs. So say a character may want revenge, but what they truly need is to forgive themselves for something terrible that happened in the past, perhaps. So a character's want and a character's need is very different. Anyway, I digress. Well, perhaps we'll talk about characters' wants and needs in another video. So sequence five, so we're past the midpoint now. And in sequence five, this is when there's like a break from the action, if you like, or a break from the main storyline usually, and it's where the subplot kicks in. It's sort of the meat of the subplot, if you like. You may have been hinting at it before now in sequence three, but at sequence five, that's sort of like when a lot of stuff happens, or in the subplot, to move the subplot forward. So sequence six, we go back to the main storyline. This is where the character's want is replaced by the realisation of the character's need, and this creates a new tension going forward for the final two sequences or the final climax. So a character could want revenge and then realise that they actually need self-respect, or a character could think that they want the cool girl but in actual fact realise that they need to see the person, you know, the nerdy girl that's standing right in front of them. Or a character thinks that they want to win a competition, but in actual fact, what they need to do is build a good relationship with their family. So basically, a character's wants are often external, and it's what a character knows. So it's what the character knows from the get-go that they want to do, and then the need is often internal, and through the obstacles or the struggles that they have gone through during the story, their need becomes apparent. And then this sets up perhaps new obstacles, or it creates new tensions or enhances existing tensions for the final climax of the story. So sequence 7 is where we find out what the main character has learned along the way. Perhaps they've lost people, or perhaps they're about to lose people, but it's kind of a self-realization, and then how what they've learned then helps them through this final section of their journey, or final section of the story. So this is the bit, like, this is the bit that you're leading up to all the way along, like, what's going to happen in the end, this is it, this is the climax, this is the battle, or this is the love scene, or this is the, I don't know, part of the movie where the most exciting part of the road trip happens. Sort of the end of sequence 7 is how will things turn out. So basically the climax could happen at the end of sequence 7, and then we're leading on in sequence 8 to how the climax has restored status quo, or the new status quo. But it could also be a point for a false resolution or a twist if you're writing a thriller, or you're writing an action film or a horror film or something like that. This is the point where you think, oh yeah, the killer's dead, and you think, oh, everything's fine and everyone's safe. But are they? You know, this is the point for that as well. Sequence 7 can be the point for the false resolution. You know, if you're setting up ready for a twist. Finally, sequence 8 is what actually happens. You know, no more twists, no more games, this is the reality. And it is also, it's basically the outcomes and the resolution. So it's what happens after the climax, it's the new status quo, or status quo re-established, the happy ending, the marriage, or perhaps the marriage is the climax, and then sequence 8 is 3 months later when she gets a positive pregnancy test or something like that. It's the last pages when everything is tied up neatly in a bow. I don't know if I've made that entirely clear, but perhaps the 8 sequence structure is something that you feel might suit your story better. I think it's particularly well suited to thrillers and action films, and perhaps sci-fi and fantasy and things like that. It gives you more of a guide of how to go and where to go in that big middle chunk of your story, which is the point when your character is going to be journeying through their obstacles and learning the most. But obviously it can be applied to a comedy, it can be applied to a love story, you know, and it's not a rule as well. You've got to remember that with all structure. It's just kind of like a guide to keep you on track, but you don't want to make it a rule, because then your work becomes formulaic, and you know, how do you stand out from the crowd with a formulaic piece of work? So always think of these acts or these structure things or these sequences as a guide. You know, nothing's set in stone, and you should always do what works for you. But I find, as a bit of an overwriter at times, that sort of keeping this structure in my head keeps me disciplined, especially when I'm writing for screen. But yes, I'm going to, hopefully, I'll just list all the sequences in the info bar below. I will also post my notes on my blog, so if you are interested in finding out more about this sequence structure and applying it to your work, then check it out there. So I hope you found that video helpful. So guys, I'm afraid my battery on my camera died, but I just wanted to say thanks for watching. And if you want to follow me on Instagram, you can find me at Jo Guards Writing Life, or on Twitter at Jo Guards. Until my next video, thanks for watching and keep writing. Bye from me, and bye from Winnie.